गेम से। ओ यार यार
इज रिकॉर्डेड ऑन दिस, इट इज रिकॉर्डेड।
बड़े ना।
यस सर, यू आर रिकॉर्डिंग दिस।
ओके ओके ओके
नाउ
ना
यू जस्ट मिनिमाइज इट सर।
दिस वन ना।
यस सर, नाउ
ओके इट इज बीइंग रिकॉर्डेड राइट। हेलो।
यस सर, लेट्स
ओके
स्टार्ट।
ओके व्हाट आई टॉक्ड व्हाट वी डिस्कस्ड दैट डे द अदर डे द इनिशियल पार्ट ऑफ आवर डिस्कशन ऑन ब्रुसेलोसिस आई टोल्ड दैट आई डू नॉट लाइक टू गो टू दोज स्लाइड्स अगेन लाइक आई विल जस्ट स्किप दिस वॉज द प्लेस वेयर द पायोनियर वर्क वॉज डन बाई डेविड ब्रूस ही वॉज एन आर्मी डॉक्टर पोस्टेड इन माल्टा एंड देर वर केसेस He from a patient who died of Malta fever or undulant fever or brucellosis, he took the the spleen, the material he took from that infected spleen. He infected monkeys and he could produce the disease. Then at the same time there was another scientist who discovered Coco bacilli from cases of aborted material from cow, and the name was given as Bang bacillus. Later on, another American scientist called Alice Evans, she named it as Brucella abortus. Okay, now Brucella, as I told you that day, they are gram-negative coco bacilli. Mainly, these belong to the group of organisms which, on a staining, they are in on a stained preparation they resemble cocci, but they are actually coco bacilli. Okay, then I told that they are zoonotic diseases. Many animals are reservoirs, and persons who handle animals, they contact the infection. Okay, we have discussed all these things yesterday that day. So I gave you a clinical case, a 50 year old man, farmer by occupation, presented with intermittent fever for the previous 3 weeks with loss of appetite, nausea. On inquiry, he admitted that he frequently attended the cattle and carried milk to sell in the nearby market. On examination, there were no other physical gross abnormalities. Which clinical condition you will think of, and what laboratory investigations in this case you will suggest in order to arrive at an accurate diagnosis? Okay. So this part we are going to discuss today. So to summarize what I have told you the other day is Brucella, the genus Brucella, consists of a group of gram-negative bacilli or gram-negative coco bacilli. Usually these are the pathogens of goats, sheep, cows, buffaloes, and pigs. Infection in a pregnant animal may lead to abortion. Also, infection in the mammary gland of the pregnant animal may lead to excretion of the bacillus for a long time in the milk. So, a person coming in direct contact with these animals, or handling the carcasses of these animals, or handling the milk and milk products of these animals, as this person has been doing, as shown in this slide. So, all these activities may lead to acquiring infection in a man. Okay, and so far as the disease is concerned, as I have repeatedly emphasized, these are zoonotic diseases. Human to human transmission never happens, but man can acquire the infection from because of close association with the animals. And so far as the disease is concerned, it has varied manifestations. Though the name has been given by previous workers as undulant fever, but that typical picture really never happens. So it has got a varying clinical picture, starting from silent infection, latent infection, or totally asymptomatic infection. Patient may present with only fever, as in this case you are seeing, or it can have chronicity, chronic infection. I will explain how chronicity develops. So sometimes diagnosis and also this fever may resemble any other fever like it can resemble with typhoid fever. So unless there is laboratory aid, 1/6 help of the laboratory, then the diagnosis, clinical diagnosis, is really difficult. Okay, now this organism, it can survive in the environment, it can survive in the soil, it can survive in the manure, it can survive in the excreta of the animal, in the products of conception of the animals. However, it can be easily killed at about 60 degrees centigrade if it is exposed for at least 10 to 15 minutes. That is why the milk, if it is pasteurized, we can get rid of this organism in the milk. Sometimes, if the milk is sour, it has become sour, then the organism is less likely to survive. And those lactic acid fermentation techniques to prepare products from the milk, they have very rare chance that the organism may survive. But it is not a hard and fast rule. It can survive in many milk products as well. Okay? And if you do the culture, we will tell about the laboratory diagnosis. Usually, its typical cultural characteristics are, these are very small, pinpoint, translucent, glistening colonies. If you make a gram stain, you will find gram-negative coccobacilli. So all these things we discussed in detail the other day. So that other day also I told that though there are many Brucella species, but these three species, so far as medical importance is concerned, so far as human infections are concerned, these three species are most important for us. What are those? Brucella melitensis, Brucella abortus, Brucella sui. Brucella melitensis, the pioneering research work was done by David Bruce. Brucella abortus by Bang, which is called Bang's bacillus. So there is somewhat host specificity, but this boundary does not hold true all the time. Usually, Brucella melitensis, it affects goats and sheep. Brucella abortus, cows, buffaloes, Brucella sui, definitely. So, but there is no, this boundary is not very hard and fast rule. It can cross the host specificity rule. Now, these three species, apart from their host specificity, they could also be distinguished by few other biochemical reactions. Like carbon dioxide requirement is not necessarily, it is a must for Brucella melitensis, but Brucella abortus and Brucella abortus requires carbon dioxide, right? When the Brucella abortus organism was initially, the gram stain was initially recognized that it is from the gram stain appearance, when they thought that it is most probably resembles the Brucella melitensis discovered by David Bruce, then they found that it is not growing in ordinary culture. It required carbon dioxide. Then some Brucella species, they produce hydrogen sulfide, that is Brucella abortus and Brucella sui, and also urease activities in majority of them are, they produce urease. Now, coming to how the disease is initiated, usually the incubation period, as I told you that day, it is 10 to 30 days. Usually the organism enters into the body through abrasion in the skin. It depends upon the profession of the individual. If he is an abattoir worker, if he is a butcher, then there is very likely that he will have lesions of abrasion on the skin. Even mucous membrane contact and skin abrasion, they can lead to entry of the organism, the host. They go to the bloodstream via lymphatics, and once they reach the bloodstream, there will be bacteremia produced. And subsequently, these organisms, after this bacterium phase, they are localized in parts of reticuloendothelial system. Sometimes in reticuloendothelial system, they produce granulomatous lesions. Survival of the organism inside the granulomas leads to grave consequences, serious consequences. What serious consequences? It can lead to repeated relapses of acute at acute exacerbations of this disease, or even it can lead to chronic. Chronic brucellosis per se, it may follow an acute attack if the organism resides inside the granuloma, inside the reticular endothelial cells, or chronic brucellosis can itself arise because of an insidious course without any previous acute episode. So, organism after entering via lymphatics goes to the bloodstreams, localizes in the reticular endothelial system. If there is granulomatous lesion, surviving inside granulomas may lead to chronicity. So, as I emphasized earlier, clinically, it is very difficult to differentiate from causes of fever of unknown origin. That is why laboratory help is very valuable aid in the diagnosis, in accurately diagnosing the condition. If you diagnose it accurately, then treatment will follow, right? So the principle of laboratory diagnosis, as in any infectious diseases, depends upon what samples. In this case, sample variability is not much. Blood is the most ideal sample from which one has to isolate the organism. Since it affects the reticular endothelial system, bone marrow may be another very good sample. Very rarely one can go for urine or sputum, so that does not come to their role is not much that important as the role of isolating the organism from blood. So the most convenient and most easily available sample for us is the blood sample. What else, apart from isolating the organism from blood or bone marrow, we can go for detection of antibodies, serological tests and other tests, okay? So we will see how these laboratory techniques help us in diagnosing the case. So about blood culture also, I told you yesterday, we use a biphasic medium, brain infusion agar slant with brain at infusion broth overlay. The advantage of this biphasic medium is that you can do the subculture without opening the cap of the bottle repeatedly by tilting the bottle at an angle of 45 degree for 2 to 3 minutes, then making it upright. So this also I explained yesterday, and how to collect blood from which place I explained to you in great detail that day. I need not go to those details now. So you collect this from the antecubital vein by properly disinfecting the skin, so that in the sample you are collecting, you are not contaminating the sample with the skin flora. Then technique of blood, drawing of blood is you tie the tourniquet in the arm, then draw the blood, as I told you that day, after disinfecting the skin. Then these blood cultures bottles we are using at Manipal Teaching Hospital in our lab. You can see there is a cap of leukoplast here because there is a hole, small hole on the lid, on the cap. In order that the blood drawn via the syringe and needle, it can be directly inoculated inside the bottle by removing this flap and disinfecting the area of the cap where the flap was lying, then inoculating the blood into the bottle. Few important things to remember while inoculating blood into the blood culture bottle, that is the BHI biphasic medium, is that these organisms are usually scanty in number in the blood and they are very slow growing. So a little bit large volume of blood need to be taken. And as you saw in the previous slide, some of the Brucella species, they require carbon dioxide for their growth, majority of them. So it is preferable to use a set of 2 blood culture bottles. One to be incubated at 37 degrees centigrade, the other is to be incubated at 37 degrees centigrade in 10% carbon dioxide, okay? So preferably draw 10 ml of blood, 5 ml into each bottle. So These bottles are to be incubated. One to be incubated at 37 degrees centigrade. The other is to be incubated at 37 degrees centigrade in 10% carbon dioxide. Now, since this organism is slow growing, unlike other conventional blood cultures which we are doing, we are after looking at them, after examining them for 7 days. But if you are suspecting clinically and epidemiologically and taking the history of the patient, taking into view his occupation, you are suspecting brucellosis, then these bottles are to be incubated for a longer period because these organisms are slow growing. We cannot easily discard these bottles after 1 week of incubation. So preferably for a period of 4 to 6 week incubation is required. And every 3 days, you have to do the subculture onto a solid culture medium plate. Okay. So these are the few important things to be remembered for blood culture. Now, nowadays, there are automated blood culture systems. These are known as BACTEC blood culture. The advantage of BACTEC blood culture system is that you need not have to open the cap and do the subculture. Because by opening the cap and taking a drop, by flaming the mouth of the bottle, taking a drop of the broth from inside the bottle with the help of a bacteriological loop, whatever meticulous technique you may adopt, but there is some chance that there will be contamination. But in this BACTEC blood culture system, since it is automated, so it will not, you are not going to do repeated subculture. Moreover, BACTEC system will give you diagnosis within a shorter time period. You do not have to go wait longer than 1 week. Okay. So at this point of time, under the purview of this lecture, there is no point in discussing the principle of this BACTEC blood culture system. But anyway, I can tell you here very shortly that this is the blood culture bottle. These blood culture bottles contain BHA broth. Sometimes these broths are supplemented with serum and glucose to enhance the growth of, to facilitate the growth of Brucella abutus, Brucella species, because some Brucella species they are exacting in their nature for growth. And there is a plate below which has been impregnated with water. So when, because of metabolism of this organism, when it produces carbon dioxide, so water per carbon dioxide, they combine to give to release of H3 ions and hydrogen ions. So increased concentration of hydrogen ion in the solution will lead to drop in pH. So once there is drop in pH, the machine can sense and the machine will beep. So one fine morning when you come to your lab, you will find that there is a beep in the machine. So you guess that there is growth in some bottle. So you can take out that bottle and do the risk procedures for identification of the organisms. Okay. Now, so this is about culture. Now coming to serological tests, which is very, very important for us to know the principles and interpretation of the serological tests. So I will tell you here, we will discuss 4 important serological tests: standard agglutination test, Markov to ethanol test, complement fixation test, and of course another is anti-human globulin test. So I will go to them one by one: standard agglutination test, Markov to ethanol test, complement fixation test, and anti-human globulin. You are not seeing this on the slide, anti-human globulin test, but I have described it on the latter slide. So remember 4 tests: standard agglutination test, Markov to ethanol test, complement fixation test, and anti-human globulin test. So standard agglutination test, usually agglutinin to Brucella, they are of IgM and IgG in nature. IgM appears first, but both the levels, they continue to rise during acute phase of. So whatever within 7 to 10 days following infection, we are able to detect the antibodies by performing standard agglutination test. This standard agglutination test is a tube agglutination test. Remember, this is a tube agglutination test in which patient serum and Brucella abbotus standard suspension provided by the reference laboratory, they are added in equal volumes inside the test tube. Patient serum and Brucella abbotus standard antigen suspension are added in equal volumes in the test tube. So, because there is high titer of antibody in some individuals, so one has to be careful to avoid Prozon phenomenon. These things, Prozon phenomenon, agglutination test, principle of agglutination test, these all these things were taught to you during your first semester teaching. So I am not going to those details. So because of high titer of antibody, there can happen Prozon phenomenon. That is, if there is high titer of antibody, there might not be optimum combination of antigen and antibody giving a lattice formation, which is the principle of agglutination test. So that gives rise to false negative result. So that is why it is always advisable to make very high dilutions of the serum, maybe up to more than 1 in 1,000, and it is more usually up to 1 in 1,280. Like, say, for example, 20, next dilution would be 1 in 40, next dilution 1 in 80, 1 in 60, 1 in 320, 1 in 640, 1 in 1280. You go on diluting the serum, diluting the serum doubly. Okay. Now, in areas which are non-endemic, a titer of 1 in 160 may be significant. But in endemic areas, usually one takes a titer of 1 in 640 to be significant. So a titer of 1 in 160 to 1 in 640 is taken as significant. So usually, standard agglutination test, usually we detect either IgM or IgG antibodies. Okay. But when the infection becomes chronic, IgM levels decline. But sometimes what happens in some cases, this low may persist in a chronic case also, may persist for months or even years after the infection is cleared. So in order to get rid of that IgM, we adopt this. This is nothing but the similar test like standard agglutination test, but in another set of test tubes, we make same dilutions, but in the second set of test tubes, we add 0.05 molar 2 mercapto ethanol. 2 mercapto ethanol, otherwise known as beta mercapto ethanol, this is a compound which breaks down disulfide bonds in a molecule. So the IgM molecule, disulfide bonds are broken, so IgM becomes inactive. So whatever agglutination we get, that is because of allowing the IgG to cause the agglutination. So this is indicative of continuing presence of IgG. This is 2 mercapto ethanol test or beta mercapto ethanol test, in which we get false agglutination given by IgM antibodies. We get rid of IgM antibodies by breaking down the bonds of IgM. Now, this is another test, complement fixation test. It is a very good test. It is effective when in chronic cases, when the disease progresses from acute to chronic, organisms gradually localized intracellularly or inside the granuloma. So agglutinating titers of the antibodies, it falls. Sometimes if you do the serological test, it does not detect any agglutination, whether it is standard agglutination test or 2 mercapto ethanol test, it does not detect because the agglutinating titers of these antibodies, it is very, very low. So these IgG antibodies, even if they are present, they are no longer capable of causing agglutination. So these antibodies can be detected by the complement fixation test. So this is the advantage of complement fixation test. And the principle of complement fixation, you must be knowing, or you might have forgotten, I do not know. But under the purview of this lecture, if I go on explaining to you complement fixation test, we have no time for that. But for to be very precise, complement will be utilized when antigen antibody reaction will be there. If you are giving the antigen in the test, providing the antigen in the test, patient serum does not contain any antibody, so there will be no antigen antibody reaction. So in your adding complement would not be fixed to the, because there is no antigen antibody complex. In order to detect that whether complement is free or complement has been fixed with antigen antibody complex, you add another antigen antibody system, that is CPRBC and anti-CPRBCs. So if complement is free, then CPRBC, anti-CPRBC, they will interact because one is antigen, one is antibody, so there will be lysis of the CPRBCs in presence of complement. So if there is lysis of the RBCs, then complement was free, then the test for antibody is negative. So this is how complement fixation test will detect whether there is presence of antibody or not. And this is valuable. It has got utility when the agglutinating titer of the IgG antibody is sufficiently low because of chronicity of the disease. In the beginning, I told you that in that slide, I had not mentioned this test. I had mentioned complement fixation test, standard agglutination test, tumor cut polyethanol agglutination test. This is a test number 4, that is anti-globulin test or Coombs test. Coombs, after the name of the scientist. His name was Coombs. So this is anti-globulin test, or anti-human globulin test. Okay. So sometimes in some infections, there are antibodies in the patient's serum which are incapable of causing agglutinations. They are called incomplete antibodies or blocking antibodies. This thing you have been taught when you might have been taught when you have been taught about Rh incompatibility. Okay. So this Coombs test is also used to diagnose what happens in Rh incompatibility. If father is Rh positive, mother is Rh negative, then the fetus in the uterus is Rh positive. So fetus RBCs, fetal RBCs, they are Rh antigen positive. Okay. So they will go to mother circulation and produce antibodies against Rh antigen. So what will happen? There might be erythroblastosis. The condition leads to, because the antibodies will come again to the fetal circulation, so there will be lysis of the RBCs. This is called Rh incompatibility, erythroblastosis fetalis. Okay. So in order, the Coombs test will help, because if you take the fetal RBCs, which have been coated with maternal antibodies, but these antibodies, sometimes they are blocking antibodies. They do not cause agglutination. So you take the fetal RBCs and add anti-human immunoglobulin, that is human serum injected to rabbit producing antibody to human gamma globulin. So if you take those RBCs, I'm talking about Rh incompatibility. So you take the fetal RBCs, add anti-human rabbit immunoglobulin or antibody to human gamma globulin, then there will be agglutination. This is called direct Coombs test. If you take mother's serum, which contains these blocking antibodies, to detect whether mother's serum contains blocking antibodies or not of the IgG type, then you take human O group erythrocytes, add these, sensitize those erythrocytes with mother's serum, then add anti-human globulin. This is called indirect Coombs test. So here, in case of brucellosis, patients are having incomplete antibodies or non-agglutinating antibodies in their serum. So what you do? You take Brucella suspension, sensitize them with patient serum, which contain the non-agglutinating antibodies. Now, after sensitizing this Brucella suspension with non-agglutinating antibodies, now you add anti-human globulin. So you will find agglutination. Sometimes these non-agglutinating antibodies can also be removed by heating the serum at 55 degrees centigrade for 30 minutes, but this is not an ideal method as compared to the anti-globulin test or Coombs test. So you have to take Brucella suspension, known suspension, sensitized with the patient serum in which you want to make the diagnosis that it is a chronic infection or not, then add anti-human immunoglobulin, then you will find that the organisms will be agglutinated, as in RS incompatibility, you are seeing diseases were getting agglutinated, hemagglutination. Here you will say agglutination of the organism. So this is the summary of the serological tests. Just now I explained in acute brucellosis, chronic brucellosis, as well as in past infection. Standard agglutination test, it will detect the antibodies early in infection. So it is valuable in diagnosing acute brucellosis. It has very limited role in chronic brucellosis. Whereas 2-mercaptoethanol, it eliminates IgM by breaking down the disulfide bonds. So it detect IgG, so it is helpful in chronic brucellosis. Similarly, complement fixation test is a very good test for brucellosis. It can diagnose acute as well as chronic brucellosis. And lastly, the Coombs test or anti-human globulin test, it will detect incomplete antibodies or non-agglutinating antibodies in chronic cases. And the principles I have already explained to you, okay? So now we are coming to the last part of our discussion, treatment. Treatment requires always combination therapy, because the physicians, the clinicians, they advocate, they suggest that combination treatment should be given. Why? Because most likely these organisms, they develop resistance if you give monotherapy, because you have to give the drug long time. So combination is helpful in treating this condition successfully. Combination therapy in the form of doxycycline in combination with an aminoglycoside, then doxycycline in combination with rifampicin. This is not an alternative treatment, but this regime is to be continued for a long period, 4 to 6 weeks, followed by the second regime. First regime, doxycycline plus aminoglycoside. So aminoglycosides, they are injectable forms. Doxycycline is oral, 100 milligram BD per day. If you are giving gentamicin, then 3 to 5 milligram per kg IV, or if you are giving gentamicin, 1 gram per day intramuscular. So duration should be for 4 to 6 weeks. After this course is complete, then it is to be followed by same doxycycline 100 milligram BD plus rifampicin 900 milligram per day. So this combination is to be continued for another 4 to 6 weeks. So this is the treatment regime. You can see textbook of medicine if you can find, and you can see that this regime has been given in the textbook of medicine. Okay. So now I think we have come to the end of our lecture. So contents of the previous lecture and today's lecture. So you have a concise, precise idea about the disease, its epidemiology, mode of transmission, clinical presentation, and clinical diagnosis, laboratory diagnosis, and pathogenesis. Okay? And what is zoonosis also, that day I told you, what are the other examples of zoonotic infections? So all these are important for you to study. Now, questions. Your doubts. Now 5 minutes time is left, you can ask your doubt. Anulekha, you are there? अनुलेखा, अनुलेखा मुखोपाध्याय, विदिशा दास, विदिशा दास,
यस सर,
ओके, अनुलेखा इज नॉट देयर, ओके, सो विदिशा एनी डाउट?
नो सर.
आर्या सिंह, आर्या सिंह, आर्या सिंह, अपेक्षा, हर इज अपेक्षा?
यस सर.
यू आर अपेक्षा?
यस सर.
ओके. इन एग्लुटिनेशन टेस्ट, ट्यूब एग्लुटिनेशन टेस्ट, व्हाट इज यूज टू डिटेक्ट एंटीबॉडी इन द पेशेंट सीरम?
सर कैन यू प्लीज रिपीट इट?
In the standard agglutination test, which is a tube agglutination test, in order to detect antibody in the patient's serum, what yes, antigen is used?
Serum, patient serum.
Patient serum, you detect antibody. To detect antibody, you have to have antigen. What antigen?
Sir?
What antigen you use?
Sheep's blood.
Oh no, it is standard Brucella abbottus suspension, equal volume of standard Brucella abbottus suspension obtained from a reference laboratory and equal volume of patient's dilutions ranging from 1 in 20 to 1 in 1280. Navya Singh, Navya Singh is there? Navya Singh, Navya Singh, Rishabh Gupta is there? Rishabh Gupta, Rishabh Gupta, not there?
Yes sir.
Okay. Why do you make very high dilutions of the patient serum to diagnose brucellosis? What is the need of making such high dilutions of the patient serum?
Can you repeat the question?
Why in case of brucellosis, to detect antibody by a serological test, you have to go for high dilutions of even up to 1 in 1280. Why? I told you something.
Because it decreases the concentration.
Because of prozone phenomenon. I told you repeatedly emphasizing that this was taught in the first semester, antigen antibody reactions. What is prozone phenomenon? What is antibody excess? Okay. Okay. Huh? Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay, bye. We'll meet in our next
session. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Pratishma?
Yes, sir.
Please send the absentee list.
Okay, sir.